Good evening, everyone. Welcome. I'm going to call the January 9th Shelby Township Planning Commission meeting to order. I'm filling in tonight for Chairman Moffitt, who is away on business. Secretary Moore, will you please call the roll?
Mr. Dallo.
Here.
Ms. DeCicco.
Here.
Mr. Bernardi, absent. Ms. Casale, absent. Mr. Appone.
Here.
Mr. Wozniak.
Here.
Chairman Moffitt, absent. Acting Chairman Turner.
Here.
Thank you. We have a quorum.
Thank you. First item is approval of our agenda for tonight.
So move.
Support.
Moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Next, approve our minutes from December 12th, 2016.
So moved.
Support.
Support.
Seconded. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. Tonight on our agenda, we have a couple of public hearings. The first for Helen Hicks, Macomb County Habitat for Humanity, 46660 and 46614 Van Dyke, east side of Van Dyke, south of 21 Mile Road. So I'll call the public hearing to order, and Secretary Moore, will you read the notice as published?
Charter Township of Shelby, notice of public hearing. Notice is hereby given that the Planning Commission for the Charter Township of Shelby, Macomb County, Michigan, has received a request for approval of the following special land use. Applicant Helen Hicks, Macomb County Habitat for Humanity, 34950 Little Mack Avenue, Clinton Township, Michigan, 48035. Proposed use, Habitat for Humanity Restore Office and Construction Storage Indoors. Location, 46614 and 46660 Van Dyke, east side of Van Dyke, south of 21 Mile Road. Site plan number 16-39, SLU-11. Sidwell number is 23-07-34-103-031. Legal description is as follows. The Planning Commission will meet on Monday, January 9th, 2017 at 7 p.m. in the Shelby Municipal Building, 52700 Van Dyke, Shelby Township, Michigan, 586-726-7243, for the purpose of holding a public hearing on the special land use application. The application for special land use and the site plan may be examined at the Planning and Zoning Department in the Municipal Building Monday through Friday from 8:30 a.m. to 5 p.m. Written comments may be submitted to the Planning Commission at the above address prior to the hearing. Oral comments will be heard during the public hearing. This notice is provided pursuant to the requirements of Michigan Public Act 110-2006 as amended. Shelby Township Planning Commission, Jerome Moffitt, Chair, Raquel Moore, Secretary. This was published December 25th, 2016. There are 46 property owners and three applicants were notified on December 23rd, 2016.
Thank you. Mr. Kirk, does this notice meet all legal requirements as stipulated in local ordinance and state statute?
Yes, it does.
And could you explain the uses under the present zoning and if the special land use request is appropriate for the district?
Yeah, the current zoning is a C1 district, which is our most restrictive commercial zone. In that zone, different uses are specified to have a maximum, allowed only a maximum square footage. In this case, the request is being made for more square footage than is allowed under the ordinance. So the ordinance provides it in such a case that the Planning Commission can then grant a special land use if they deem appropriate.
Okay. Anybody have any questions for our attorney? Hearing none, I'm going to open the hearing, and the format will be as follows. The petitioner or his or her representative will give a presentation stating the reasons for the request. The commissioners may then ask questions of the petitioner. The floor will be open to the public, and then the petitioner may make any concluding remarks. And if she's ready, she can come on up and make the presentation. Please sign in when you come up, please, also. Oh, and while they're doing that, Secretary Moore, have we received any correspondence on this?
No, we have not, Mr. Chair.
Okay, thank you. You can go ahead if you're ready.
Good
Good evening. I'm Anthony Rupino with Pilot Property Group. I'm the real estate broker representing Macomb County Habitat for Humanity. I'm here with Helen Hicks, the CEO of Macomb County Habitat, and also Rob Johnson, the CFO. Here to explain a little bit more about Macomb Habitat, their operation, and then specifically in regards to the site plan that we submitted on how the building will be used for both restore and administrative purposes. The building off Van Dyke is formerly, the last use was the Great Lakes Hobby and Train. It's currently been vacant a little over 8 years, and Macomb County has a agreed upon purchase agreement in order to purchase the property and bring it back to life. So I'll leave it to Helen and Rob to discuss any concerns or questions that you guys may have.
Good evening. Thanks for having us. We appreciate it. My name is Helen Hicks, and the mission of Habitat is to provide safe, affordable homes for those in need. The building, however, will be used as primarily as a restore. There will be an office in the building, and there will be some construction equipment inside of the building. I asked Rob, our chief financial officer, our chief operating officer, to be here with us this evening to talk a little bit about the plan and a little bit about the building itself and some of the concerns that the community may have.
Good evening. Thank you for having us here tonight. The building will mainly be used, like Helen said, as our restore, which is a way for us to supply financial support for our affiliates so that way our donated dollars can go to our actual projects, which is building safe, affordable homes for low-income families. The restore will be housed in the main access of it. It's about 12,000 square feet. We'll have a donation bay, which all drop-offs and everything will be on the Van Dyke side of the building from our public, so that way everything will be located away from, as far away from the residents as possible. We will also store any type of construction tools that we need on site in a separate bay located on the south side of the building, as well as anything we need for our homes, like Whirlpool donates washers and dryers for our homes. Those things would be stored in there as well. But like I say, the main portion will be for our restore, which is open to the public, which is all to serve for construction costs.
This came back because when you came to us in November, it could be done administratively, but we decided it would be best if the public had an idea of what was happening.
Absolutely.
And we got a chance to really thoroughly discuss this with you. Mm-hmm. And I appreciate what you've done. I got a couple of questions, though. I'm looking at the layout that you have here for the building.
Yes.
How many consumer drop-offs do you have, would you estimate, a day?
A day we have about 3 to 4. We do about, I'd say, 15 to 20 during the week. When we're open Tuesday through Saturday. We are closed on Sunday and Mondays.
So who typically would come then and drop off items? I'm thinking like a Salvation Army where you have lines of people coming through. How is this different from the Salvation Army?
It's very similar, but we don't deal with clothes. But yes, usually we get a lot of people who are cleaning out their homes and have like a couch or something. Most of our drop-offs are anywhere from 1 to 4 items at a time. So usually somebody's in there for maybe 5 minutes while our guys unload their car, and then they're on their way.
And that's the same year-round? You don't have rushes at Christmas time or any other seasonal?
Nope. We average the same year-round. A little bit more in the spring maybe because people are doing their spring cleaning and digging out their basements and stuff like that. But other than that, it's pretty much consistent.
Now, in the back, there is a gated area. And I know Mr. Moffitt last time asked about outdoor storage. What is that area behind the building? What is your intent for that to be used for?
Well, right now, that's actually the septic field. So we can't really do anything heavy on top. We do it's called foam board that we put on our foundations of our homes. We were thinking about maybe possibly storing it there and tarped. It'd be covered and everything. It's real light foam board that can't be damaged by weather or anything like that.
All right, and the northern door, where it currently shows a couple of trucks that are parked there, that's typically only going to be used for your truck at the end of the day bringing things to the
Correct.
Store?
Our truck will actually be stored at our Clinton Township in the morning, so there won't be any early morning startup from there. They drop off anywhere from 3 to 4 p.m. at the store, and then they'll be taking it back down to Clinton Township.
Okay, thank you. Any other commissioners have any questions they'd like to ask? Mr. Dallow?
In reference to the outside storing and the drop-off, are these done by appointments, the drop-off, or people just come and drop things off?
The outside storage is for our construction team, so nothing will be stored out there that's not part of our construction department. but the public can just pull up at any point in time. It's not done by appointment. Anybody can pull up any time during store hours, and our guys are ready to unload for them.
So what is the need for the outside storage then if you have people at your facilities unloading the merchandise?
Right. The outside storage, these sheets of foam board are 4-foot by 8-foot sheets, and we have about 200 because it takes 48 of them on each basement that we pour and dig. So it's just the volume of them. They would take up a large amount of space indoors. So since they can't be affected by weather, we're looking at possibly storing those outside if possible.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else? No other questions? If not, we'll open it to the public. I'd like to explain, this is the format for the public hearing. Oh, I think I already did that. Did I say that already? I think I did. Okay, now we'll open it to the public if they want to come up and ask any questions of the, what we'll do it this way. If you bring up your questions, ask us the questions, and instead of going back and forth, we'll take the questions down, the concerns down, and have the petitioner come back up to address them all at one time when you're finished with your questions. So anyone from the floor wishing to speak on this? Going once, twice? Seeing none, okay. Bring it back up here. That was kind of easy. Mr. Rubino, do you have anything else you'd like to add?
I'd like to just add a couple of things. One, we are very similar to the Salvation Army in that we sell product in our building at very, very reasonable costs. But we have a large number of folks that come in to purchase who are actually people who have homes, vacation homes, they flip homes, that sort of thing. I think it's important for you to understand the very interesting and diverse group of people that are shopping at our store. The other thing I'd like to say is we really loved getting involved with Shelby last year. We started with a grant from the Shelby Foundation, and we've gone out and worked on seniors and veterans' homes, and I feel like we've been welcomed, you know, because we have done that, and we've gotten to know these seniors, and actually, we delivered gifts, and I know that you were part of that as well, to folks in the community this holiday season. So we really enjoy the opportunity to be a part of the community. I just wanted to add that.
Mr. Wynn, I have a question on the outdoor storage. Even though it's not affected by weather and it's tarped, do we usually allow that in C1?
No, we don't. But if there's some inclination to maybe allow that, I'd want to look at that a little more carefully and see another plan and make sure we know exactly where it is, what's going to be stored there, and how it's going to be stored, because we don't want to have this impact the residents.
Was that something you just heard now? Because that's the first I've heard about it, too.
We do have alternate storage. If that is not acceptable, that is fine. We do have alternate storage areas for that.
Personally, I would prefer that not to happen.
I would, too. I mean, and if it turns out they want to come back and request that again, we could maybe bring that back. But I wouldn't want to complicate this by adding that to this right now because I need to study that a little more.
Yeah, no, we have somebody step forward that's donating some storage area if we need it for that kind of product.
So. And you're closed on Sunday and Monday. You never have to be open on Monday because if you set off at the hours of operation close Sunday and Monday, you have to, if you want to change it, you have to come back. You never open on Monday?
No, we are open Tuesday through Saturday, 5 days.
Okay. Any other commissioners with comments or questions? If not, I'll hear a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved. Support.
Moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries. The commission's recommendation must be based on the following: the compatibility with adjacent land uses, consistent with and promote the intent and purpose of the special land use, compatibility with the natural environment, consistent with the capacities of public services and facilities affected by the proposed use, protect the public health and safety and welfare, and the adequacy of public access to the site. Planning Commission may recommend approval, disapproval, or to table it to evaluate the information received this evening. Motion would be in order.
Mr. Chair, I'd like to make a motion to recommend approval to the Township Board for Special Land Use Application 16-39 to permit the reuse of the vacant retail building at 46660-46614 Van Dyke for Habitat for Humanity store based on the following findings. Adequate access is available to this site from Van Dyke. The business will require very limited outdoor loading and unloading of merchandise. The principal loading doors are on the west side of the building facing Van Dyke. The proposed use will facilitate the occupancy of a vacant retail building along Van Dyke. This particular building is well suited to this use and based on the information provided by the applicant. Due to the size and configuration of this building, the reuse potential has been limited. The hours of operation shall be from 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. Tuesday through Friday and 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. on Saturday. The building will be closed on Sunday and Monday.
Mr. Chairman.
Okay, we got a second on the motion, Commissioner Moore. Commissioner Dowell.
Can we adjust number two with the limited outdoor loading, storage?
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Wynn.
It said loading and unloading. It didn't say storage, so nothing about storage is allowed now. They'd have to come back and at a later date.
Thank you.
Any other questions or comments? Hearing none, take roll. Commissioner DeCicco?
Yes.
Commissioner Moore?
Yes.
Commissioner Dallow?
Yes.
Commissioner Wozniak?
Yes.
Commissioner Appone?
Yes.
And Chair votes yes. Thank you. Good luck. Next item is also a public hearing, SEPA number 16-38, PUD 5 for Alex Wansier, shops at Notting Hill Village on Hayes Road. Secretary Moore, will you please read the notice as published?
Charter Township of Shelby, notice of public hearing. Notice is hereby given that the Planning Commission for the Charter Township of Shelby, Macomb County, Michigan, has received a request for approval of the following addition to a planned unit development. Applicant Alex Wansier. West Point Park, LLC, the shops at Notting Hill Village, 31731 Northwestern Highway, Suite 250, Farmington Hills, Michigan, 48331. Proposed use, addition to retail center, 5,000 square feet with a drive-thru. Location, 53153 Hayes Road, northwest corner of 24 Mile Road and Hayes Road. Parcel number 23-07-12-400-046. Legal description is as follows. Planning Commission will meet on Monday, January 9th, 2017 at 7 p.m. in the Shelby Municipal Building, 52700 Van Dyke, Shelby Township, Michigan, 586-726-7243 for the purpose of holding a public hearing on the planned unit development application. The application for planned unit development and the site plan may be examined at the Planning and Zoning Department in the Municipal Building Monday through Friday from 8:30 a.m. to 5 p.m. Written comments may be submitted to the Planning Commission at the above address prior to the hearing. Oral comments will be heard during the hearing, public hearing. This notice is provided pursuant to the requirements of Michigan Public Act 110 of 2006 as amended. Shelby Township Planning Commission, Jerome Moffitt, Chair, Raquel Moore, Secretary. This was published December 25th, 2016. There were 78 property owners and three applicants were notified on December 22nd, 2016.
Thank you, Mr. Kirk. Does this notice meet all legal requirements as stipulated in local ordinance and state statute?
Yes, it does.
And could you explain the uses under the present zoning and if this special land use is appropriate?
This is currently zoned C1 district, but it's under a PUD from 2004. So what they're asking for tonight is an amendment to that plan. There was always a plan for this area. This one's a little bit different, so they're coming in to amend that PUD for this purpose.
Thank you. Anyone have any questions for our attorney? Did we receive any correspondence on this one?
No, we did not, Mr. Chair.
Okay, thank you. The format for this public hearing will be as follows, very similar to the other one. Petitioner and or his or her representative will give a presentation stating the reasons for the request. Commissioners may then ask questions of the petitioner. The floor will be open to the public, and the petitioner may make any concluding remarks. I see the petitioner is here. Come on up. Let us know what you want to do. You can sign in too.
Good evening. My name is Mark Drain. I'm with Rogvoy Architects.
My address is 32500 Telegraph Road, Bingham Farms, Michigan, 3250. I'm here tonight to, Alex Wansier from the ownership is here as well, and just briefly, this is kind of like a pad that's been sitting there for quite some time, undeveloped. We thought we would put it to productive use, and we're looking at putting a 5,000 square foot building in that pad. It will be probably what we're seeing in the marketplace, some sort of fast casual restaurant, drive-through, coffee, juice, something like that. We don't have any tenants yet, but the idea is to architecture be very similar to the existing architecture, trying to fit seamlessly right into the spot it was intended for.
Okay, Mr. Nguyen, you want to kick this off for us? Go ahead on the PUD.
As Mr. Kirk mentioned, the original PUD was approved in 2004, and most of the parcel has been, the commercial site has been developed except for this pad. Just offer some just preliminary comments on the site plan. We'd like to see an overall area map that shows how this fits into the overall PUD. This is a good design showing where it fits relative to the inline buildings. But for the file, we'd like to have that larger one. Because this is a PUD, the reason it's here for is a PUD amendment is there's two provisions that it doesn't comply with fully in the C1 district. One is the drive-through lane in back of the building, and the second is a portion of the building is 28 foot high, the corner tower, and it's 25 foot is a limit. As part of a planned unit development, the Planning Commission has the authority to modify those standard requirements. The only concern we have about the drive-through aspect of it is making sure there's adequate landscaping in the back. When the site plan was approved, there was a fairly dense row of pine trees in back of the retail building, kind of shielding this from the duplexes to the west. Over time, some of those evergreens have died, and when the new owners took over, we asked them to replace them. They did replace some of them. They've been very helpful in that regard. But since this is an increase in intensity, we want to see that doubled up so that there's, you really, if you're sitting in any of those duplexes, you couldn't see the drive-through at all. And the revised plan reflects that. So they've done a good job, and this new owner's been a real good steward of this property, unlike the previous one. So we're happy about that. We want to make sure the hours of operation are limited to the C1 district requirements, which is 7 a.m. to midnight, nothing after that. Roof-mounted screening details are missing. I know typically in Mr. Drain's plan, those units are shielded by a parapet wall. If that's the case, that's fine. Otherwise, I mean, this is a very nice plan. It was what we originally envisioned, the only wrinkle being that drive-through lane, and making sure that any impact of that is mitigated through adequate landscaping.
When this original PUD was approved, even though the pad's been vacant, did they envision a building with a drive-through there?
No, but there was much talk about it, but nothing was ever submitted.
Okay. Any commissioners have any questions for the petitioner? Okay, at this time we'll open it to the public for any comments or questions. You can come on up. Going once. Oh, come on up. Make sure you sign in for us too, please.
Mr. Chairman, just you asked about the past. I think it was always envisioned that this pad would be a restaurant pad of some sort.
Okay. Good, how are you?
Good. My name is Dave Gorshevitz. I live in the duplexes behind there. We're actually pretty excited about something going in there because it's been empty for a while. Hopefully somebody comes along and finishes our complex at the same time. The only concern I have in a few of the other residents there, I don't mind. Can you pass these along?
Sure.
There's an older residence on the north side of Fryer Lane. Fryer Lane tucks into Hayes right there where they're going to be building that. Well, with the new building there, and if it's a drive-in type restaurant, it's going to increase the traffic flow there. The problem with the residents to the north of that, if you notice the huge pine trees right up against the road there. So when we're pulling out on the Hayes, you have a real obstructed view from the north. A couple of years ago, my son's friend was pulling up there, and people are coming 45 miles an hour, and that's a cut-in lane to go into the complex. He had his front bumper ripped right off. If there's going to be the building, the restaurant, or whatever, we would like to see them pine trees, something done with them, taken out of the way, because if you notice, I don't know if I provided you with the right article, the general provision there. There is not supposed to be an obstructed view on a corner. You're supposed to be 25 feet off the road. Them things are right up along the road, and it really makes it complicated there pulling in and out of that. And if the traffic increases coming in and out of that complex, it's just going to be a bigger hindrance for the people of the complex there. So that was pretty much my concern.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Wynn.
First of all, you did cite the right reference.
Did I?
Yeah, absolutely. And fortunately, it's not these gentlemen's problem to solve.
Oh, okay.
It's the neighbor who I think owns that property to the north where that single-family home is.
Yeah.
We can pursue that independently through code enforcement. I mean, this isn't the first time we've had similar sites like this, and your observation's spot on.
Yeah. It's a pain. It really
yeah.
is.
I've been there many times visiting the residents, and you pull out there, it's hard. So we can ask code enforcement to follow up with that.
Yeah, something should be done because it is on the other property, but it's not just a pain. It's a serious hazard.
Hazard.
Extremely.
If you add more cars there, you're going to have a bigger problem.
We have a variety of residents there, older, younger, you know, families and kids just driving, coming up. And when you have to actually pull into the lane to see the traffic coming, anything can happen.
That's right.
Okay.
Well, thank you.
Thanks for your time.
Anyone else wishing to speak? Come on down.
Hi, my name's George Rassi. I'm the president of Notting Hill Village Association. We're adjacent to the property. Most of the concerns that we had, and we've worked with Alex, she's been working with us, I think have been answered. One question I had was on the drive-through, if there's enough vehicles in the drive-through, we don't want it blocking Friar Lane coming in off of Hayes. So that was a concern that I had. Obviously, we don't want a McDonald's or a Burger King type of business, and we didn't want a 24-hour business, but I think that's been addressed. So that was my main concern. If there's enough vehicles in the drive-thru, it could possibly block our entrance, and it's only a two-lane entrance.
Okay.
Okay.
All right, thank you. Anyone else?
I'm Tom Riggio. I've been living in Shelby for 20 years, so I lived in Royal Forest, chose to move to Notting Hill Village condominiums. It's a beautiful site. This, the 10 of you need to do a virtual tour of this area that needs to be developed, and a restaurant there, I don't quite understand. I'm not opposed. I know a restaurant has always been proposed since 2004, but a drive-through restaurant, for any of you to go there tonight, just look at it. Unless there is really some density created with some tall trees, and as I leave the podium, I would hope Alex or his representative, his architect, would really tell us what trees will be developed. Will there be a need for some sort of wall? The proximity is so close. I really could order probably a coffee from my deck and call and shout out. It's really close. So that's a major concern because that would be dealing with the value of my home. I had a friend who once lived in East Point, and they chose to build a Hardee's behind his home. And he never sold that house. He's still, to this day, it's being rented. It's been being rented for 30 years. Nobody wants to live that close to a restaurant, let alone a drive-through. I don't oppose the fact that it needs to be developed. A restaurant's fine. However, if you saw, once again, I wish a virtual tour, if we actually got in the car right now and we drove this going into this area to park, to go to this drive-through, it really doesn't make any sense. I mean, I know they do their marketing and they're not going to waste money, all right? So they do market, and if they see a need for a drive-through, okay, but it just, it, to me, it's going to be very, very dense with cars. We already have people driving through our complex off 24. They'll be coming through our complex and doing the horseshoe to get to that restaurant. It's, and safety is also a concern. I am on the board, and I do keep up with anything that happens in our community. I've worked very closely with Glenn. Glenn has been very, very good in trying to get some berm, or not a berm, but to get some buffer, and he did make some good attempts to do that. A couple trees were replaced. The fact of the matter is, you guys, it's very dense. It's like each of you is a tree right now, and I can see that building. It needs to be heavily dense with shrubs, tall shrubs. And if it's a two-story building representing 28 feet, I would also like to mention lighting. All right, will there be lights way up there that will reflect back on the units? Thank you.
Thank you. Did you sign in, sir? Thank you. Anyone else wanting to come down and speak? As you come down, I'm going to read one notation here. This is the only public hearing the Planning Commission will hold on this special land use request. All remarks will be entered into the record for Township Board evaluation. We are a recommending body, and the Township Board will evaluate our recommendation, which is the legislative body. The Township Board will make the final decision on the special land use request.
Approved the restaurant. We knew all along there would be a restaurant, but not the drive-thru. Really, Tom said, it is very close. I am the first condo that will be adjacent. One side in front of me is the where all the trash is collected, and the other side of that will be the drive-thru. So I don't see the need. There's a veterinarian there that's going to be going right by his building. He has a very many clients who come and go all the time. They take the dogs, because clients coming in and out all the time with all those cars. That's right where the drive-thru is. So I have no objection to the restaurant. I see no need for a drive-thru right there. It's just not that the property's not right for it. Thank you.
Thank you. Did you sign in, ma'am?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else wishing to speak?
Janet Frisbee, and I also live on Friar Lane. We're new to the complex here and weren't aware that this was going in. My big concern is that coming in on Friar Lane off of Hayes, they would be coming in a residential street. It's not a main street that they would be coming in. If they're coming in to go to that restaurant, they're coming in off of our residential street. I'm not sure of other restaurants out there where you go to get to them through a residential area. So I guess for me, that's my biggest concern. And if there's children or whatever, they're going to be on that street. There is no other street other than Friar Lane and Celtic and that whole subdivision.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else? Going once, twice? Okay, well, come on back up to the board. And you want to come on up again, the petitioner? Yeah, there you are, right there. We'll address some of these concerns that were brought up. As far as your drive-through and the stacking, there was concerns there may not be enough. They may end up looping out to Friar Lane.
Yes, I heard that. We're providing 6 stacking spaces, which I think is the ordinance requirement, but there is the ability to stack 8 cars there. So okay. In my experience that I've done a few of these, this not being a fast food, you know, high volume type freestanding McDonald's or Hardee's, it's almost always adequate. I think it's a good plan.
And Mr. Wynn, as far as the trees and the wall screening to the residents to the west there?
They're showing an additional 5 evergreen trees to fill in the gaps, and they're 8 foot, 8 foot versus 6 foot, which is the standard we require. So, and I think, you know, to Mr. Riggio's point, I guess I'm happy to accept the 5 right now, but with the understanding that if that doesn't, you can't really tell until they're out there, that we would allow, require, I guess, those 5 plus whatever additional is necessary to fill in the gaps, because you really can't tell. When you see a tree stamp on a plan, it's really hard to evaluate, is this adequate? So I wouldn't want to not leave open the opportunity that we might need a few more to adequately provide that screening.
Certainly not a wall you would put there,
no.
Right?
I mean, this landscape, I think, is more effective, particularly if they're going to make them taller. That would be the best long-term solution, because then you get more height. A 6-foot wall, you're only getting 6 feet. And that wouldn't be adequate. So I have no problem with that, subject to the additional trees that may be necessary after they're, you know, when you get out onto the site.
What about the lighting on the building? There were concerns about the residents,
sun
shining
that
on the residents.
The only additional lights, and correct me if I'm wrong, Mark, I think are wall-mounted lights.
Correct.
And they're all going to be pointed down. And to address the comment, this isn't a two-story building. It's just that one of the architecture features is a little taller. So you're just going to get light, building lighting pointing down.
Because we had that concern on Kroger, pointing,
yes,
toward the homes, pointing down.
They're all pointed down.
Okay.
And there's a photometric plan that came with it that validates that.
Okay. I think that was all the comments that were brought up. Any other commissioners have any questions, final questions, comments?
Mr. Chairman, I have one other suggestion.
Go ahead, Mr. Wynn.
I know the concern is the drive-through, and part of the problem is we don't know who that's going to be. You know, because what we're having is we're finding a lot of these buildings, they add the drive-through to kind of induce some you know, tenants that might want that as an ancillary sort of feature, not being the McDonald's or the that standard sort of drive-through, which I wouldn't want to have here anyway. Maybe one way to resolve it is that when we get a certificate of zoning compliance, I present that to the Planning Commission and share that with the residents so we know what it is. So we at least have some way of at least making sure that tenant fits here.
Because even though it may not be a McDonald's, if you get a coffee shop during peak hour, you're going to have a lot of cars stacking.
Yeah, we might have to reevaluate that, because 6 wouldn't, you know, might meet the ordinance, but it might not be sufficient. So, I mean, I wouldn't mind moving this forward, but at least holding back a little bit until we get to see what that use is going to be.
Okay.
Some days it might just be a sandwich shop that wants that drive-through,
right,
feature that doesn't really impact anybody. And I think a 2,000-square-foot building isn't going to be a McDonald's.
No.
Yeah.
My guess is it's going to be a sandwich shop. I mean, that's what I see in the market.
Right, but I think, we don't want to, I wouldn't want anybody leaving here thinking we don't have another little chance to revisit that, to make sure we're getting a use that fits here. That would be then be subject to the final approval certificate of occupancy, subject to the Planning Commission's approval.
Okay. Anybody else have any questions?
I do just have a question.
Go ahead, Secretary.
Just to piggyback on Mr. Wynn's comments. And then at that time, then, Glenn, would we be able to then maybe reduce the hours? Or what is your thought?
I think the hours are adequate, because we're keeping the C1 hours. I mean, any of those tenants in that shopping center would have to abide by those hours anyways. I just want to make sure the fear is that we could get a McDonald's or a Burger King here, which this isn't designed for that. But I'd still want to make sure we have some way of just checking off the box one more time, having one more step in that process.
Thank you.
Anyone else?
Yeah.
Mr. Wozniak, go ahead.
Thank you. The traffic pattern that you have anticipated for the drive-through, are you anticipating all the traffic coming from Hayes?
Yes.
And not from 24 Mile?
Yes.
But it looks like it's readily accessible from 24 Mile, but a car coming from 24 Mile would have to do a U-ey to get into the drive-thru. Is that what I'm seeing?
I believe so, it is. Yeah, it would be awkward to do that.
Yes.
Very awkward. Or they could come in from, you know, further down Hayes and through that other entrance and then loop through the parking lot.
But actually, with the way the plans were promoting the problem that the neighbors are complaining about, I think. If we can anticipate some traffic off of maybe 24 and and not cutting through their Friar Lane as much, we might be a little better off. Do you think, Mr. Wynn?
I think there's no way around really sharing that to some degree, unfortunately. Some degree,
yeah.
You don't have any concern with them coming in on the residential street to go to the restaurant?
Well, they're coming off the driveway, which Friar Lane becomes Friar Lane when you get through the parking lot, really. Friar Lane's part of the parking lot until you get past the retail. So it shares a function.
But my thought with this plan, though, we're actually pushing all the traffic to Friar Lane.
Yeah, I hear what you're saying, unless it came through the parking lot. That may be what happens, too, though. You know, people come in through that other. There's a entrance to that further south on.
Right. Mm-hmm. And that pushes them to the north also.
Yeah.
I want to look at a rethink on that.
Mm-hmm. Or I guess could you come in the opposite way?
Yeah.
Anyone else have any questions or concerns, comments? Hearing none, do you have anything more you'd like to add, sir, or is that about it?
No, we came here to do a good job, and typically we do. Somebody talked about maybe refocusing the drive-through the other direction. My experience is it's very difficult to get coffee from the passenger side of the car. Caution, contents are hot. But anyway, I think, I know that Friar Lane provides a dual use. It's part of the parking lot, it's part of the driveway for the shopping center. I would expect that most of the drive-through patrons are going to come in through the front and make a loop counterclockwise and then come back out to Hayes Road. That's what I expect. I think it's going to be more of a convenience type drive-by on the way to work, on the way home kind of use, and I don't think it's going to be something where we're going to be drawing traffic through the neighborhood to get to the drive-through use. That's my opinion.
Okay, thank you. If there's no other questions or comments, I'll have a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Support.
Moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. The Planning Commission's recommendation must be based on the following standards: compatibility with adjacent land uses, consistent with and promote the intent and purpose of the special land use, compatibility with the natural environment, consistent with the capacities of public services and facilities affected by the proposed use, protect the public health, safety, and welfare, and the adequacy of public access to the site. The Planning Commission may recommend approval, disapproval, or table to evaluate the information we received this evening. Motion would be in order. Is my mic working? A motion would be in order.
Mr. Chair.
Yes, Secretary Moore.
I move to postpone approval of the PUD amendment for the shops at Notting Hill Village, number 16-38. PUD-4 for the following reason. The proposed amendment right now is not consistent. Well, it was originally consistent with the original PUD plan approved in 2004. But the main reason is I feel that the site plan should be revised to accommodate the drive-through and revisit another option, relieving some of the traffic flow off of Friar Lane.
We have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments on the motion? Hearing none. Secretary Moore.
Yes.
Commissioner Wozniak.
Yes.
Commissioner Dallo.
Yes.
Commissioner DeCicco.
Yes.
Commissioner Appone.
Yes.
Chairman votes no. Motion carries. Thank you. OK, Okay, moving on. Item number three, rezoning petition number 10-16, Fadi Saman, West Utica Ryan Properties. This is at the corner of West Utica and Ryan Road from R1B to C2 and R12. Revised plan. See, Mr. Ruggieri is here. He can fill us in with what's changed since he proposed it in November.
Good evening, everyone. For the record, Phil Ruggieri on behalf of the petitioners. If you'll recall, the last presentation that was made, we talked about 10 years ago, there was a proposal to have a 7-Eleven and all commercial zoning on that entire parcel, and then our proposed development was two commercial components and then a residential component that consisted of 16 stacked ranches, and then there was a oil change and lubrication facility in the middle, and then we had the convenience center with service station on the direct corner. Since that time, we've had an opportunity to digest the comments that were made by the residents and the concerns, and they were very noteworthy concerns. What we had done is, first and foremost, we took the portion of property that was to the north that consisted of the proposed 16-unit apartment complex, and we've eliminated that and created three duplexes that have two driveways to get in and out of the area. Each building consists of 3,000 square feet, 1,500 square feet per unit. They are extremely attractive, well-designed units, as you'll see in your packet. And what we have done is created a substantial amount of buffer to the north, to the west, and to the east, as well as the front. We have a very nice berming area. That gives a lot of residential character to the neighborhood, and what it does is protects that property owner to the north substantially. It now blends in and adds significant value to that property, and it has zero impact on that particular homeowner. And then to the west, Eagle Creek will have no impact from that property. In fact, these units are single-story ranch units. They are substantially lower in height to the Eagle Creek Condominium Association development itself, which are two-story. So that parcel is a substantial deviation from the original proposal that we had. In fact, we had asked for R12. We've asked for R2 zoning to accommodate the three duplexes. So that is just a notch above R1B. And as the as we discussed last time, that the R1B designation will not be developed under that particular zoning. There's no way you're going to put homes along that corridor, which in this instance would be 10 homes with 10 driveways abutting on Ryan Road. It's just not practical. The property's not deep enough. So that goes without saying that this is probably the best use that you could have for that property. The second feature that we've done to modify is we've eliminated in the middle the commercial component that consisted of the oil change and the lubrication. That's totally out of the equation. All we have left is the commercial component on the corner, and what we've done is we've pushed the building somewhat to allow for a substantial green belt on the rear of the property, which does not allow for any traffic to go behind the building, and we've established buffering on a substantial basis between the duplexes and the commercial component, and we have landscaping throughout the entire building, and there's three pump areas, which are six actual pumps, which is a minimum that we would provide for the area. And we've got a substantial distance between that particular piece and Eagle Creek. I think it's around 300 feet before you can reach the first unit to the west, which would be Eagle Creek. The design features of the gas station and the duplex are significant. They're in your packet. The commercial component is very residential in character. It's a state-of-the-art brick building, nice facade. It's an excellent character. It fits in very nicely. because I know when I had rezoned the property across the street for this applicant, we have the 72 units, there was a lot of concern about all this multiple coming into the area. Well, we've now softened it down where we have nothing but residential, takes care of that component, and we provided a commercial component to service the area. We think that with the design features and the consideration of the residents' comments, I think we've met a substantial burden to bring a development that makes sense in the area and has the most minimal impact on the residents. You can see that a lot of the properties, particularly west of the duplexes, is under a conservation agreement for wetlands. It'll never be built. So there's a substantial buffer to the west. I think that all the residents would be a lot happier with this development from the last one that we proposed. So we tried to make an effort to meet all those needs, and I think we've accomplished that. So if you have any questions, we're here to answer them.
I'll start off. I definitely think what you did with the residential component is a big improvement from the last time. It gives some diversity down there, but it gets away from this cookie cutter apartment after apartment after apartment, which we already have in that area. I'm still struggling with the whole concept of putting a commercial on that corner. I'm not yet quite convinced that, because when you look at the area, and then we have Auburn Road to like 2 minutes to the north, 2 minutes to the east, you've got all the commercial, 2 minutes to the west, you've got a gas station. I'm just looking at it thinking that commercial looks, to me, looks out of place. Now, maybe some other commissioners could change my mind, but I'm looking at it thinking, I'm not sure it belongs. I like the design of it, but I'm just not so sure that the commercial goes there, because the current master plan does not envision commercial. And I believe, Mr. Wynn, I don't think the revised master plan is not considering this to be commercial either.
Not at this time.
So that's where I'm kind of like trying
to get comfortable.
I understand.
And if you look at the characteristic of the building, it meshes very well in a residential character.
I would agree with that.
Which really softens that impact. That particular building is a page right out of Wixom. It's a proven factor. It's a beautiful building. I brought it to Mr. Wynn. I think he would acquiesce in that. I think it's a very, very soft use. And I think that it'll blend in well in the community. I think it's been 10 years since someone had brought a proposal. I think this part of the Shelby Township could use some development. I think that property's been dormant for a lot of years. You're not going to get any other development in there. You're not going to get any single-family homes.
No, I agree. Right.
You're not going to carry that duplex to the corner, because no one's going to want to live on that corner. And I think this is probably one of the better uses. I've done a lot of zoning cases, and I put a lot of effort with my clients and made sure that we addressed a lot of those substantial issues that were raised last time. And I think you would be very, very happy with this development, especially with the buffering that's involved. There's a lot of trees and landscaping in here that isolate this entirely from Eagle Creek and from a homeowner to the north, and it makes a nice presentation and presence to the passerbyers and the people that live in the area. They're not going to look at this as a big apartment complex. They're going to say, these look like homes. And then that building itself that sits there is very attractive. It's not one of those run-of-the-mill type facilities, like a typical gas station. It looks like a beautiful building, and it's all brick with stone. It's very attractive. So I think it's a welcomed addition. It's far superior than any of the buildings on Auburn Road.
The property to the west, where there's currently nothing built, but there's a road going through there, that's where you were talking about, that's buffered through a conservation easement, or what?
I'll point out.
Go ahead, yeah.
Remember doing that conservation easement several years ago for Eagle Creek, because I rezoned all that property for Eagle Creek, and it's a very nice development, and it's contained, it's very private, and they've got a lot of buffering itself with all the wetlands. And now you have our development coming in, and we're maintaining that feature with all our landscaping and buffering. So I think they've been well protected. This is not you know, corners are generally, you know, game for development of this nature, but we've gone the extra step, and we've laid out exactly what we want to do. In fact, we're willing to go forward and say we'll provide this under a contract zoning to commit to this particular site plan, elevation, and landscaping plan, so that you're secured in knowing that this will in fact come into play and you won't be deviating from that just after you just get the zoning and come in with another product. We want to stick with this product.
It was mentioned at the last meeting, I believe somebody mentioned that the idea is to have a walkable area because it is residential, that whole intersection pretty much currently. And with a gas station, I can only think of one reason why you would walk if your car runs out of fuel. Yeah. I'm still trying to come to grips with whether that really belongs there. I appreciate what you've done. It's a far better than what there was, but I'd like to hear other commissioners, but I'm still not totally convinced.
Sorry. No, I appreciate that. Thank you for your comments.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else have any? Mr. Dallow, go ahead.
To the fact of the master plan, we have seen some outer space master plan. I think this project is out of the box type thing. A small development, it's a neighborhood need, and it's not a gas station that you're going to run out of gas, you go there. There's different gas station, I understand, but that road there, there's a lot of apartments, a lot of neighbors there that they could use that specific use of a gas station, not to be out in the main streets, main roads. So in reference to the master plan, I don't know any corner in my mind personally, I see it as a commercial, and this is very light commercial use that will be well-maintained and well under control by the neighbors, by the community that is surrounding. It's not a whole road type gas station where you're going to see a lot of traffic and a lot of needs for it. But for the neighborhood need, this will be something that I feel will be required. I don't mind having it in my subdivision or close to my subdivision.
If I may make one point.
Go ahead, Mr. Ruggieri.
If you look to the bottom left of my board, that shows you the amount of multiple that's in the area. There's over 3,000 units in that area of apartments, condos, et cetera. And that is a lot of residents. And there's a need for providing them convenience with the service, with the convenience center and the gas station. And that's one of our studies that's showing. And we think it would very well support this commercial need. And the other side of the coin is that our traffic study allowed those two components that we had for commercial, but now that we've taken out the oil change and the lubrication, we've significantly reduced any more traffic coming in, so it's even less of an impact than our first proposal. So with that combined and the 10 units lesser of the apartments, so you've got a lot less impact, even though our original traffic study showed that we would not have a problem. Now we certainly have no problem.
Any other commissioners want to ask any questions?
Mr. Ruggieri, I'm sorry.
Go ahead, Mr. Wozniak.
Just had you considered separating the gas station from the convenience store ever? Did you do study on that?
We had our engineer and architect take a look at that. That is we've got the minimal amount of property to utilize for our development for the commercial sector. I don't see how you're really going to separate it. That's the only way it can lay out from his review.
Physically, I mean, just forget the gas.
No, you need it. When you need the gas, it just doesn't make it practical or economically feasible.
That was my question.
No, we can't separate in every. If that was your question, no, cannot separate it.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Mr. Appone, go ahead.
Is there a reason that there's so much parking in front of the condos? It looks like there's, 26 spots?
I think we provided just extra spots for visitors, et cetera. We just thought that that was the best area to put the parking. We got a nice landscape buffer to the front. It gives a lot of flexibility to the homeowners so that if their families want to come by, they've got ample parking. We don't want them going on the street or going down the road. It just makes it much more attractive. There's more than you need for that site, but we want to make it a nice private development that, you know, I've encountered a lot of traffic problems for multiple developments. This eliminates that problem. We've got a lot of space, so let's utilize it and make it very useful in providing it more parking.
Thank you.
Well, that I would agree with because I live in a duplex condominium complex. It's small, and we could use more parking, so I can see why you would want that out in front. That makes sense.
I do have a question.
Go ahead, Commissioner Moore.
Mr. Ruggieri. Hi. As far as the duplexes, would those be for lease or are they for sale?
You know, I think they're extremely attractive duplexes. We could go either way. We could sell them or we could lease them. I would prefer to lease them. They're going to be beautiful buildings. They're all brick. They can last a long, long time. But I think that's open. They may be sold. They may not. I don't know offhand. It's going to be a very attractive investment, though, to keep.
Any idea on rents?
Well, the rent is going to be closer to that $1,500 a month, maybe more. It's not going to be a cheap rental. No, because the building is a substantial cost, and you've got to have a, if you're going to rent it, it's got to be a high return. And if not, then they'll sell them. But I think that they're going to be there for a long time as rentals. I think so. I would.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else?
Oh, they are two-car attached garages, too, by the way.
Now, even though this is not a public hearing, if anyone would like to come down and let us know what you think about the plan, you can do that. Just maybe when you come down, make sure to sign in.
That's a good idea.
I'd like to.
Go ahead, sir. And we are open to complaints as well as compliments if about the plan, so be a little positive if possible.
Good evening. My name is Ed Balak, 72,000 last year, Romeo, Michigan. I have owned this property along with a relative since about 1992. This property was part of a larger parcel that we owned. The rear parcel was sold and is now developed as Eagle Creek Condos. The present Ryan Road frontage has been on the market for sale for the past 11 years. The parcel has approximately 610 feet of frontage by 200 feet in depth. There has been considerable interest in the property over the years by investors and developers, but have been consistently discouraged after visiting City Hall to discuss a change in the zoning for their anticipated use. Several deals have been negotiated, but the deals didn't go forward after denial of rezoning request for their proposed use. In the meantime, we have paid over $29,000 in taxes on just this strip of property, just in this past 11 years. We have been kept in limbo by the township, unable to utilize or sell the property. And I feel that it is time for the township to allow for the highest and best use of the property and grant approval for the current proposed plan. The property is currently zoned residential. The intersection has been widened with a traffic light installed on the corner. Having been a commercial real estate broker for the past 50 years, I can assure you that no one is going to build a house on that corner. And feel it is time for the township to grant permission for its proposed use as a commercial multiple development as requested. I think it would blend in very well. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else wishing to comment? Got to come down. Got to jump up faster. Stand up. We won't miss you next time.
My name is Shane DeWitt. I live two streets over from
that. Okay, wait. We're going to have to come on up here and speak, and then you can sign in afterwards, sir. Come on over and speak, and then you can sign in after.
My name is Shane DeWitt. I live two streets over from this complex and close to the wetlands, and the plan looks good except for the gas station. You're going to put $1,500 townhouses or whatever they are in a gas station on the corner, and there's a senior citizen kitty corner from that. I mean, it just doesn't, the gas station doesn't fit. And it's going to, I don't know how you're going to rent those places or sell them or get anybody, you know. It'd be nice to keep it nice and residential in a nice area. That's it.
Okay, thank you. Go ahead. I won't ask anybody. Come on down.
I live on Kenmore. In the
your name, please.
Oh, Sharna Grooms, I'm sorry. I live in that neighborhood, and there's a 24-hour speedway right down the street we cut through. That's more than efficient for everyone in the neighborhood. You also have Vineyard, which is a party store that provides hot food as well at the other end of the street. There's no reason for a gas station to be right there. There's kids walking from school. You have the senior citizen home at the corner. I just think that it would cause a lot more problems and that traffic. I just bought a house in the neighborhood 2 months ago. I don't want it. So that's it.
Okay. Thank you. Make sure you sign in. Thank you. Anyone else? Good evening.
I'm Nicole Summers, 3604 Eagle Creek Drive, Shelby Township. I spoke last time I was here. First of all, Mr. Dello, do you live in our neighborhood?
Yes, I do.
Where?
Well, I'm in 22 Mile.
Okay.
But I pass by there a lot.
Okay. Nobody in our neighborhood wants a gas station there. When we bought it, we were on the assumption it's all residential. I'm sorry if he paid a lot of taxes, okay, over the last 11 years, and now he feels that the township should approve something because of money. Well, there's more to money. We have to live here. We have a gas station at 22, or excuse me, at Auburn and Ryan. We also have one on Utica and DeQuinder, and we have one on DeQuinder and Auburn over to the west of DeQuinder. As for walking in that area, the only people that walk are up to the Vineyards. We have a liquor store, party store, and there's a lot of apartments there, and that's what you see, people walking up to the Vineyards. It's not usually for food, it's liquor. If you go across 59 on Ryan and you go into beautiful Sterling Heights, they have a lot of homes, they have a lot of condos, apartments in that area. At 19 on Ryan, on the southwest corner, no, excuse me, southeast, there's a strip of property there, and somebody placed three homes there. You did not see Sterling Heights making it commercial, because the person couldn't sell it. And one person in the very middle of those three homes left his home, and he's an older home. So why would we want to put a gas station up the road when they didn't do it over there? They left their neighborhood all residential. We do not have a freeway exit at Ryan in that area. You have one at DeQuinder from 59, and you have one at Mound Road. There is no need for a gas station, and I find it very difficult to believe that the traffic is an issue. If you're going to put all those duplexes there and all those houses there, do you think there's not going to be a lot of people coming in and out onto Ryan from those? When I walk down Utica and I have to cross at Ryan right now, it is a death trap. And from approximately 3:30 in the afternoon to probably about 6:30, 6 o'clock, from 19 Mile all the way up to 22 going northbound, we are at a dead standstill there. And I know they said they did a traffic study last time, but that traffic study, I believe, was for them to make money, to know how many vehicles was coming up and down Ryan Road, not for our safety, not for the congestion there. And I believe if any of you drove down there, during that time, during the week, you would see that there's a lot of traffic. And a gas station there, I think it's just absolutely ridiculous. And I don't have anything else to say. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year. Thank you.
Thanks.
See, we ended it positively. That's good. Anybody else want to make any comments? Yeah, go ahead, sir.
My name's Paul Pulley. I live at 3587 Eagle Creek Drive. We purchased our condo about 2007. We love it there. Have no issues. You need gas. There's two gas stations. You got Speedway going down to Ryan and Auburn, and then you got Marathon, which is down the other way on DeQuinder and West Utica Road. As far as gas stations, I've worked at gas stations for probably about 5 years. I got a cousin that owns a gas station that I helped him start his business years ago, and he had a chain of them. He owns the Shamrock Gas on the corner of Van Dyke and M59 on the northwest side. And there's a thing called venting. The tanks underground, there's a vent. When they vent, you got tankers coming in. You're going to have the smell of gasoline going through the neighborhood. And I've worked at a lot of gas stations and experienced that. 8 Mile and Emily, worked for Larry there for several years. 11 and Gratiot, Larry owned that one. I worked for him. And my cousin, like I said, he owned several of them. So I know all about the traffic it's going to bring in, the gas, the tankers that are going to come in, the venting of the the tanks underground into the up out of the ground into the atmosphere. It's just to put a gas station there is it's not a good idea at all. As far as like in Eagle Creek, we're having issues there too with you're either going to lease or you're going to buy. And when you have too many people leasing, it's hard to buy, plus it's hard to sell your home. So if you put up a gas station there, it's going to be twice as hard to sell your home because we're buying ours. The only two options we have is walking away or a short sale. Because we bought it right before the market dived. So it's all I could say is the gas station, no way. I don't see it. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Hi, my name's Dave Major, and I'm the house just north of the property in question. And I'm wondering, from looking at this, that building in the back portion there, what is that? I don't know what that is. Can it? Toward the back, beyond all the parking space.
That's a plan.
No, that square piece there.
Mr. Chairman, that's the old plan.
That's the old plan. Yeah, that's not the current site. This is the current one here.
Oh, okay.
They put the wrong one up. Yeah, that's the current one.
All right. I like the idea of the duplexes. I think they'd be fine in that area. But again, I mean, really, if you count in the area, we have 4 to 5 gas stations very close to us. I mean, there's the ones that people were mentioning. There's one at DeQuinder and Auburn. There's another one just up the street from that.
Valero.
It's another gas station anyway, but it's within another 4 or 5 blocks of the Marathon. So as far as gas stations, I just don't see it. More of the duplexes, that would be fine to me. I mean, that looks, I think that's a good use. They could still rent them out. But I know that I wouldn't want to pay $1,500 for a duplex next to a gas station. I don't see it. So that's my concern. I mean, The other looks good. I think that's a great change in it, but the gas station just doesn't fit to me either. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Mr. Ruggieri, you want to come back up? Any other commissioners want to? Oh, you want to come up, sir?
There's two more.
Most of these people have covered just about everything I wanted to cover, word for word.
Can I get your name, sir, please?
Jim Cable, Shelby Township. I do own a home near this area, and I bought it as a residential property. Now, I've been paying taxes for 20 years. I'm sorry, I understand your plight, but you bought it as a residential property, and you should be stuck with that. I don't think I'm going to get my place rezoned and have that problem. But one of the comments you made was, is the natural environment, that's part of your criteria. Is this good for the natural environment? One of the gals pointed out, or the gentleman, about the underground tanks. Is there a possibility that these are not good for the surrounding wetlands that they have back there? Is that land going to be able to hold the weight of that gas station and those duplexes? Is it going to be a 24-hour gas station or a convenience store? I would like to see this traffic study that was done. Have any of you seen it? I don't know if that has included the apartments that the same person is building across the street from that. As a traveler on that road, and my wife also, that does get backed up from 19 to 22 mile. The assistant planner, I spoke with him the other day, and he reiterated that fact that there is quite a bit of traffic problem there. That's all I have.
Thank you. There's a comment made about leasing versus buying. Just so you know, the township can't regulate what we do as far as leasing or buying. That's up to the homeowner or tenant. Go ahead, ma'am.
Okay. I'm Christine Powers. I've lived in Eagle Creek since 06, been there 10 years. We have 20 acres of wetland. Gasoline, we all know the mistakes that are made. We have our animals back there. I back up to the wetlands. I bought there because of the wetlands. I would hate to see something ruin our wetlands. I think everything else has been pretty well covered. So gasoline does not belong on the corner. We have enough in the neighborhood.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Rist. Oop.
Tom Ranger, 5000 West Utica Road. Good evening. This is not a contract rezoning request. I take any modified site proposal presented tonight with a grain of salt, as it is subject to change once this area is rezoned, and any new site plan resubmitted would be acceptable as long as it complies to its new zoning parameters. Therefore, I am opposed to this rezoning proposal for the following reasons. Number one, I do not believe commercial development zoning at this location is compatible with the master plan. We do not have to have commercial development at every single intersection in Shelby Township, much less at this inner, smaller residential intersection. The introduction of new C2, commercial development, and the highest density allowable, R12 multiple family development, at this location is inconsistent and out of context with the zoning, development pattern, and flow of adjacent parcels, and will, number two, adversely affect the health, well-being, and safety of pre-existing residents in adjacent areas because of the much higher traffic volumes associated with the new C2 commercial development. Number three, I believe allowing for a rezoning to commercial development at this location is going to encourage a rezoning of the vacant parcel on the adjacent southwest corner at West Utica and Ryan to a commercial zoning in the near future, and it's currently zoned a much less intense single-family residential R1B. Number four, bringing in new commercial zoning where none has ever existed before in an area already developed residential will lower the property values of adjacent residential homes. Number five, commercial development at this location will create nuisances such as light pollution from parking lot lighting, car headlamps, and perhaps noise pollution from commercial patrons potentially loitering outside, smoking, slamming car doors, or honking horns at all hours of the day or night, and potential odors in the surrounding area associated with any fast food preparation if this developer so chooses to put it in the new C2 zoning area. Number six, this rezoning request of R1B to highest density allowable, R12 multiple family, and C2 commercial will allow for development that is even more intense than the original rezoning proposal several years ago by Mr. Balak. Back then, the request was R1B to O1, single-story limited, professional office, and C2 commercial, both of which were rejected by a previous planning commission. So I would expect similar reasons for lack of recommendation for this rezoning to the Shelby Board of Trustees from this planning commission tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone want to bring anything different that hasn't been spoken about already? Okay, Mr. Ruggieri, you want to come back up?
Sure, thank you.
Some of the comments were the lights on the building. You want to note?
Sure, the lighting itself would be retained on the property itself. All the lighting would refract downward into the site. It would not go outward onto the adjacent properties whatsoever. The lighting systems today are high-tech. That's a non-issue.
About the hours of operation, 24 hours?
Will not be a 24-hour store, no. We don't have the hours yet, but I would assume that we're looking at maybe 11 o'clock type thing. Yeah, you know, 6 o'clock in the morning maybe.
Because if your competition is 24 hours, I would think you'd want to compete.
I don't think so. I don't think we want to make it a 24-hour store, no. We're not looking at that. And we certainly could lock it into that, too.
Any other commissioners have any questions?
I do have a couple of
go
comments.
Ahead, Mr. Ruggieri. Go ahead.
Ms. Summers indicated that you don't put gas stations next to residents. Well, last Tuesday in Sterling Heights, I obtained a rezoning for a convenience center that was at 19.5 in Mound, and behind it is all residential. There's a cul-de-sac that abuts the 6-foot masonry wall next to the convenience store, and I obtained a gas station to add into that property. It's a little unique. You've got the building first, then we added the gas station. I talked to all the property owners. There were several that lived in the neighborhood, and they acquiesced because it now provides a better buffer because we had a lot of shrubbery, a 50-foot berm, and they're totally happy with it. In Sterling Heights, very strict community, much like ourselves. I obtained the zoning. That was on Tuesday. Secondly, the traffic studies that we have, they're required by the township. These aren't for the developer. We've done our homework beforehand. These traffic studies are to determine what type of impact we'll have on the road system. And I provided that to our planner, Glenn Wynn, and it showed that it was a minimal impact on the traffic in the area. Now, we've taken out, as I indicated earlier, the lubrication and the oil change, and I've lessened from 16 units to 6 units on the multiple factor, so the impact is negligible. It's not even there. So I took care of that issue. The residents keep saying they're adjacent to a gas station. Eagle Creek, the closest unit,
300 feet.
Then you've got all kinds of wetlands there, and you've got all kinds of buffering from our development. So you're not having really any proximity to these adjacent properties. They're just so far away, they're not even tangibly adjacent to this particular development. It's amazing. We have about 7 or 8 residents speaking tonight. And I pointed out, without counting all the homes, whatever, there's 3,000 units there. So you've got a lot of people that aren't concerned about this. In fact, are welcoming it. Otherwise, this place would be full of people. Okay? So I'm just pointing that factor out. I think it's important to note. Now, the wetlands, this development has zero impact on the wetlands. We've already done a wetland study. Our particular property does not have wetlands on it. That's why Mr. Balak was able to put it under contract, because this is a developable upland area. All the wetlands are conserved and preserved, and they're not going to be built upon. Our property is a clean piece of land. It can be developed. Now, the proof is in the pudding. This man has owned the property for 27 years. He has not been able to develop it. Why? Because you cannot, under the R1B classification, develop it. No one's going to do it. We've had several proposals for commercial and multiple components. They've all been shot down. The last one at 10 years ago was all commercial, and that was shot down. I've come in here with a nice blended development that fits and it works. And it's an opportunity for Mr. Balak to recover some of his money that he's invested in this property. He has a right to develop it. And if we don't allow that, then we're never going to develop anything. That's why you have planning commissions, you have Board of Appeals, you have Board of Trustees. You go to those forums to give an opportunity to take a parcel of land that's very difficult to develop and find a balance that makes sense. That's why we have these particular forums. Now, I think he's been a very patient man. He's spent a lot of money on that property and to maintain it, and we're coming in as developers to do this, to develop that property, and we have a right to do that. And it makes a lot of sense as to what's going on. Otherwise, it's going to sit there for a lot of years again. Now, we're putting in some solid tax bases here for Shelby Township. We are not creating new traffic. The people that are going to go to this particular gas station's convenience center are the people that do live there. Yes, you can go to Auburn Road. Yes, you can go to Rochester Road. Yes, you can go to Mound Road. But that's just like CVS and Rite Aid and Walgreens. They're all over the place. Just like at 25 Mile Road, you got Vince and Joe's. Now you got Kroger coming up, and you already had Myers. Okay? I mean, it's the same thing. People like choices. They may not like development that happens, but you like to have convenience. And I guarantee you that if you need gas, if you only got to go a couple hundred feet versus another mile, you're going to go that 200 feet. And you're fortunate that it's there, instead of running out of gas. So they're great arguments that the residents make. I know they have a resistance because they're worried about their property, but we have done all the precautions from a design team that protects those property owners. You've got substantial buffering around this entire property. Eagle Creek is not even going to see it. And the neighbor that's to the north, please, I didn't interrupt
you. Hold on. Yeah, let's go ahead.
The homeowner to the north, he has zero impact. You've got that gas station separation with its buffering, has no impact on the three duplexes that we're creating. They're going to be isolated and private, and they're not going to have any issues. We will have no problem selling them. We'll have no problem renting them. And they're 1,500 square feet. They're worth $1,800 to $2,000 a month, but we're thinking it's going to start around $1,500 if we do rent them. So I think that's a very viable development. I've been at this 36 years. It's not my first rodeo to try to find something that makes sense. I'm a Shelby Township resident. I'm not going to bring any garbage to our township. I'm here a lot, and I make sure that we bring good, solid developments to our community. We've spent a lot of time thinking this through. We've cut to the bone what we thought would make sense and to protect the residents' concerns. So we need a balance here. Okay, and we think we've met that balance. We have given a minimal amount of residential. We've got a minimal imposition with the commercial component. We've covered the bases here. We don't think there's anything here that is going to cause any impact on these property owners. And it's our property that's adjacent to the gas station, not Eagle Creek. They're 300 feet away, and anybody across the street's far away. And the property owner to the north, he's far away because he's buffered by the three duplexes. So who's really impacted? Our future renters or buyers of the property. And 300 feet for Eagle Creek. with all the buffering. So there's no impact. There's no issue about property value. There's not an issue here whatsoever. It's a great development, and after almost 30 years of sitting here doing nothing, it's time, because nothing, you'll wait another 30 years to do anything with this property. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Wynn. I have a question. The original one was R12. Now he's saying he wants R2, but our plan here said R12. Is there a...
Well, let me get to the, I think there's a question of substance in terms of the development plan and the rezoning, and there's a question of process. And let me address the development plan, the sort of plan first. I think we all recognize that this plan is a huge improvement by the introduction of the duplex units, the reduction of the commercial. I think all those are good factors. I do have that same concern that you do have, Mr. Turner, about not really envisioning commercial here. That doesn't mean commercial is not appropriate. So, you know, I think there are ways to address those compatibility issues through good site design. That gets us next to process. So this came as a straight rezoning application. We're just considering the zoning and not looking at a site plan. And I think to address some of the commission's concerns and the neighbor's concerns, Mr. Ruggieri said, let me introduce a plan. And I think that helps give us a better feeling for it, what could happen here. But as one of the residents correctly pointed out, if we don't approve the plan with the rezoning, we're missing, we don't have that opportunity to link them together. And that's done through what's called contract or conditional zoning. So it seems like we've evolved to a point where this becomes a contract application, which is attached to the site plan, which is a perfect way to do it. Mr. Ruggieri did it with the one at 21 and Shaner to benefit everybody. So having said that, because of the time frame when this was submitted during the holidays, you know, we've just done a very preliminary review. We haven't had the normal vetting for all the township departments and the engineer. So I think if Mr. Ruggieri wants to pursue this, then I don't know if we can take final action tonight because we need that final site plan approval. And it's really a matter of just giving us the plan so we could put them together in packages and give them to all the departments. It looks like there's sufficient detail here to review a plan. But I don't know how we can do that all tonight because I haven't had that opportunity to review this plan in detail. I've seen some things that I like, the additional landscaping in front of the duplexes, the way they reoriented the gas station building, so the back of the building and buffering faces, you know, is residential. But there's ways of showing those relationships that might satisfy concerns about impact. But again, I just, you know, this is the first site plan back after the year, and we haven't done the thorough review of it. Again, I think the purpose of this meeting was to introduce this and see where you want to go with it. I do acknowledge there's been a lot of improvements made, and it would probably benefit from having that detailed site plan analysis.
So would we table this to get a detailed analysis and a site plan, or what would we do?
You have the option tonight of advancing this to the board with a recommendation, but you couldn't do it as a conditional zoning without the detailed site plan analysis, I don't believe. I think if Mr. Ruggieri wants to do it this way, that would be the proper course. I don't think you could take action tonight.
I would be a little more comfortable personally if I saw more of a detailed plan, like you said.
Can I make an example?
Go ahead.
An example would be the buffering. You know, there's a lot of landscaping on here, but I don't know what the size of those trees are, and you know if they're sufficient. You know, would they be sufficient to screen? And my first impression is this is a lot better than the last one, and it offers those protections that the last one didn't. But I wouldn't feel comfortable saying I can validate all those requirements. But I'm a lot more comfortable with what's been presented tonight.
You know, I think we've taken some steps forward. I agree. I'm a little hesitant yet. I'm not quite yet convinced all the way, but I am moving in that direction, but I'm not quite convinced.
Mr. One more thing. I think there's a value in having this because, again, Mr. Ruggieri made a good effort to find some middle ground.
Well, I think he did a great job on that, and I commend him for that. I really do.
There's been some significant design improvements made, too, here. But I don't think we've really, you're not focusing on those details, we're focusing on the big picture.
Right.
Which, those are good things to focus on. I mean, those comments that we heard tonight are valuable. Now we need to drill down a little deeper and say, do these details somehow mitigate some of those big picture items?
Okay. The other commissioners have any? Go ahead, Mr. Dowell.
Speaking of the big picture, this is really the only road is Ryan from M59 all the way up to 23. where we located in Shelby. There's no development. I don't remember the last time there was a development, and it's about time that somebody wants to do something that we need to do changes. We need to do that. And the other road is Auburn. It's the same picture from DeQuinder all the way to Mount. There's no new development. These two roads need attention, and I understand the gas station is probably not the most wanted by the neighbors, but this is also, and correct me if I'm wrong, Mr. Kirk, this is a state regulated also. The state will be after the gas station as far as underground tanks and all of the additional uses for it. So that will help us as a township to dictate what is right, what's wrong for that gas station. But the development is really needed in this section, both Ryan and Auburn. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Mr. Wozniak, go ahead.
I appreciate Mr. Wynn's comments, and I think they really go along with what his written comment was, if you get into it, about talking about proposed multiple family, and it could accommodate, not that it would, but it could, and the possibility with sensitive design, it may be possible to introduce retail at the corner without impacting the surrounding uses. Is that my understanding?
It is.
Okay. So I think this comports with what Mr. Wynn has given us in his written notes with what he's planning to do here is and try and get more detail for us to give us something really positive or something really solid to vote on. Thank you.
And from what I heard from the residents, they seem to lack a lot of those details because a lot of the questions that they brought up were things that they could see on a plan they may be more comfortable with.
Let me give one more example. You know, Mr. Ruggieri has repeatedly indicated what's around there, particularly Eagle Creek. But the site plan that was submitted doesn't show that relationship. So oftentimes we've said, let's see a cross-section between the property showing. Here's where the building's going to be. Here's the landscaping. Here's where Eagle Creek is. So you begin to see relationships. You know, I do this all the time, and I'm beginning to see those. And as Mr. Wozniak pointed, I see things that might be able to address those. I guess the question is there a design solution to this problem? And there may be, and I think it's worth exploring that. I never thought we'd find a design solution to 21 in Shaner. Yeah. But, you know, we spent a lot of time, and we found it. You know, I think it's worth the effort. You know, not everybody's going to leave here feeling happy about it, but I think we do us a disservice to everybody if we just say no without thinking about the solution. The answer may be no. We don't know what the answer is going to be, and I'm making a recommendation to you, and you're making a recommendation to the board. So there's right. Plenty of opportunities, but I think we would be doing a disservice to the board by not investigating this more fully. You don't want to send a recommendation without that information. I wouldn't feel comfortable with that.
So, again, you'd rather that we could table this to get the detailed analysis and then?
Just a matter of giving those plans and the appropriate number. We do the distribution. We do the review. We bring it back to you.
And I think that would help, again, with the details that seem to be lacking from some of the comments.
Right. And I don't think that was the intent was to do that tonight. I mean, Mr. Ruggieri did a good work by bringing this to us, but we have to do that analysis. We just have to.
Okay. No, we've already, No, we can't. We've already come back up. We can't do that. Sorry.
Mr. Chairman, this comes back. There'll be that opportunity.
Yeah, I think the commission's got a very good understanding of what the concerns of the residents are. We're not going to get into a back and forth, ma'am. I'm sorry. We're not going to do that. It's not a public hearing. What I did is I had the residents come down if they had something they wanted to share with us at the time. But this is not a public hearing. When it comes back, and it's going to have to come back for me to be comfortable with it, you can make your comments at that time.
Is it going to be a public hearing at that time?
Mr. Chairman, we've always had public comment.
This was not a public hearing tonight.
This one is not.
But I did give... I'm sorry?
It's brought back to you with a more detailed point.
I can tell you that if Mr. Moffitt's sitting here, he will do the same thing I did and give the residents a chance to come up and speak. We can always err on the side of inclusiveness. There's nothing wrong with that.
Yes.
So is there a motion on this? Any other questions or comments first? Is there a motion on this plan?
Question for counsel.
Go ahead.
Proper motion to postpone. Do we have to give a lot of reasons, or can we just postpone?
You can just postpone, but I don't think you should give them some direction as to coming back with a site plan, proper site plan, that meets the ordinance.
All right. So would you understand that? All right, Mr. Ruggieri?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. And I would move to postpone with the applicant coming back with a site plan detailed so that we may have more public discussion. And I know you'll take advantage of trying to meet with the neighbors again, too. So that's my motion.
Support.
Moved by Mr. Wozniak, supported by Mr. Dallow. Any questions on the motion? Hearing none. Commissioner Wozniak?
Yes.
Commissioner Dallow?
Yes.
Commissioner DeCicco?
Yes.
Commissioner Moore?
Yes.
Commissioner Pone?
Yes.
And chair votes yes. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Next, site plan number 16-40, Auburn Hickson LLC. This is on north side of Auburn between Ryan Road and DeQuinder, a preliminary review of a planned unit development. Mr. Wynn?
Mr. Chairman, before the applicant gets up, let me just give you some background. You may recall back in 2006, this plan was first submitted for consideration. Same name, Stone Ridge North. It proposed a reuse of this parcel and some additional property to the east for a mixed-use residential development that included a combination of several different forms of attached housing and some single-family and commercial. That plan was approved. And then the site plan expired because they didn't move any forward with the development process. It was reinstated, or application to reinstate. I think that wasn't finalized. In any event, we've had some conversations with the applicant and his design professionals about coming back. And the plan that was resubmitted for your consideration tonight is a preliminary PUD only. Is completely different than the one that was originally submitted, much less intense, much more single-family balance, not multiple family. So I'll take a step back and maybe let Mr. Epping give his presentation. I'll offer some summary comments afterwards, if that's okay. The preliminary PUD process is meant to just introduce the plan to you and give you a chance to say, do you think the plan has merit? If you conclude that, then they would come back at a subsequent date with a more detailed, final detailed site plan, and we'd have a public hearing at that point.
Okay.
Thank you.
Mr. Epping, come on up. Two things you said that I like very much. Less intense and more single family oriented. I think this has an opportunity to become something very unique and very creative for the Southwest area.
Absolutely.
Go ahead.
Good evening. I know you've had a long night, so we'll be brief, but here to answer any of your questions. I've had the opportunity to meet and be before many of you, but I see a few new faces. My name is Jim Epping. I'm a land planner and landscape architect out of Clarkston, and I've had the good fortune to be working with your team in Shelby Township for the last dozen or so years. Tonight I'm representing Auburn Hickson LLC and their development team, and the Auburn Hickson team has owned the property at the northeast corner of Auburn Road and Hickson Road for the last several decades. As Mr. Wynn mentioned, back before the downturn in the economy, we were here for a few years working with the township on the property. At that point, of course, the economy was very bullish. We were looking at an awful lot of multiple family on the site. The site is really terrific in the sense that it has a very significant lake, nearly 50-acre lake, which, of course, adds some value, some excitement to the property. That PUD was approved in 2006 with about 642 units. I should back up and say that the land is currently zoned R10, which under just straight zoning allows about 710 units. So at the time it was zoned R10, allowed 710 units, we had it approved for 642 units. Probably the day after it was approved, the economy started to slide down. We didn't do anything with the property, and even though we came back in with a few revisions, again, nothing was done with the property, and so that PUD expired. And currently, right now, the zoning remains R10, although the PUD is not in place. The original 2006-2007 PUD is on the bottom there. Just for reference, I can answer any questions about that. Just for point of reference, it had about 7% single-family homes. So out of the 642, we had 46 single-family homes and 596 multiple family back in 2006. Tonight what we're doing is, with a number of the properties that Auburn Hicks and their investment team owns, is we're really looking very closely at the communities and saying in today's economy, 2017 now, what makes the most sense for Shelby Township, what makes the most sense for the residents, where's the market going? And of course, we're all excited to see the market coming back, and Mr. Chairman, you mentioned single family homes, of course, seem to make an awful lot of sense. We agree. We're looking at this as a three-phase project, and what we're bringing to you tonight is phase one. Phase one is about two-thirds of the property, or about 44 acres out of the 70 acres of buildable land. Phases two and three remain on the east side and are shown in that green area. For phase one, we're looking at predominantly a single-family neighborhood. We're proposing 259 total units. Of those, 97 would be single-family homes and 162 units of apartments, and those are shown in that center area closer to Auburn Road. Those would be five three-story buildings housing 162 rental apartments. We also are showing a small portion of commercial development on the southern corner at Auburn and Hickson Road. There's two buildings proposed there. One 2,200 square foot commercial building with a drive-through, perhaps it's a coffee shop or something like that. And the other is an 11,000 square foot inline neighborhood retail building that likely would have convenience, neighborhood convenience stores, dry cleaner, those type of things aimed for the residents in this neighborhood as well as those traveling up and down Auburn Road. What's nice about the proposed plan in today's market is we believe we've done a good thing not only for the property but for the neighborhood adjacent. Along Hickson Road and moving towards the west, towards DeQuinder, there's a very nice residential neighborhood. If you travel down, going north down Hickson Road, you'll notice that our site has quite a berm and quite a bit of brush. Obviously, that'll all be cleaned up, but we were able to buffer the neighbors to the west by creating a nice landscape buffer that ranges from 35 to about 55 foot wide before you come into the backyards of our homes. We haven't done final engineering, that'll all be parts of the next few phases, but we anticipate that that berm by and large will be able to remain there. We'll clean it up, we'll keep a lot of the existing trees and shrubs and then add to those trees for a buffering. Our single family homes range in size, or lots I should say, range in size. They're all designed as a minimum of 120 feet deep and range in either a 70 foot width along the lake or 50 foot width in the inward lots. The neighborhood will be comprised of open space. There's a 10% requirement of open space. We far exceed that in phase one and certainly would continue to exceed that in the future phases. We can get into some preliminary utilities. We provided some information like that, but again, a lot of that information comes in the future phases of the process. I will say, in terms of phases two and three, we don't have any preliminary designs. We would anticipate that it would be very, very similar in nature to the residential components, the single and apartment uses. But again, we don't have any densities in of that. If we were to max out and go with R10 for those other acres, in a worst case scenario, that would add 220 homes or units, I should say, which would bring us up to a total of 480, still would be a 40% reduction from the existing zoning. If we continued at the 5.88 proposed density, which is what we're showing now, it would only add about 130. Additional homes would be at 390 total units, or a reduction of about 45% below what's allowed with the zoning. So, I would anticipate that we would continue to build out at about that 5.5 to 5.8% density. I'm happy to answer any questions or respond to any comments from the community.
I just have a question. How far north along Hickson are you going to go? All the way up to Paragon, where that cement company is there?
That's correct. Right at the top of our property is where that cement company is. You can see that we've got an awful large open space on the corner there. That's both to protect our residents, to get rid of some of that dust and so forth. But yes, we go all the way to the northern property line.
Okay. Anyone have any questions or comments? I can say that this is, to me, it seems like an ideal situation for a PUD when you have the single family, you have the rental apartments, and you have the commercial all bundled together. This looks like a good walkable community to me, a little walkable area. So we'll see.
I appreciate that. We're planning on having sidewalks throughout the site, as well as with all the open space. We've got a lot of opportunities for paths.
Okay. Mr. Wynn?
No, the only other thing, I would agree with all those comments. The other plan was good, but it may have been overly ambitious. I think this is really strikes the right balance. And at this point, we're not looking at all the details. They'll provide those details at final review, and then we have the formal public hearing. But I feel very strongly in favor of this plan.
Any other comments? If not, a motion would be in order.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Appone.
I move to conclude that this project has merit and the potential to meet the requirements of the zoning ordinance and authorize the submission of a final plan.
Support.
Motion by Mr. Appone, supported by Mrs. Moore. Any questions on the motion?
Good point.
Go ahead, Mr. Wozniak.
The shoreline rights of the homeowners. What will be the shoreline rights of the homeowners along the lake? Will they own their shoreline?
Yes. Yeah. I mean, we would have to, of course, have a condominium association bylaws, but it's intended that along the residential portions that they would have exclusive rights to their backyard as opposed to having a promenade. However, there will be other open spaces where other residents within the neighborhood can enjoy that shoreline.
I know it becomes an issue on the lakes we already have here, whether or not people can walk around.
Yeah, no, we don't anticipate a public path or a neighborhood path around behind people's lots, but in the open space, they'd have access to it.
Thank you.
Okay, any questions on the motion? Commissioner Appone?
Yes.
Commissioner Moore?
Yes.
Commissioner Dallow?
Yes.
Commissioner DeSico?
Yes.
And Chairman votes yes. Motion carries. Mr. Wozniak? I forgot somebody. Sorry about that. And chair votes yes. Motion carries. Thank you. Again, this is preliminary. The final plan will come back, and we'll get more specific about it later on.
So we don't get to comment on that.
When it comes, Mr. Wynn?
When we have a public hearing, that's the opportunity.
Yeah, when it comes back for a public hearing. This was just to give the developer an idea of whether we think it has the merit to proceed.
Then you'll get
notified. Everybody within 300 feet. Or if you want to get notified and you live outside the 300 feet, let Mr. Wynn know and he'll get you the notification.
Glenn, you know me.
Just write it down. Write your name down. Write your name down.
I'm not trying to hide anything from anybody, believe me.
This isn't when we have the public hearing.
No. Moving on to site plan number 16-41 for Jörg Hensel, vacant land over in Shelby Parkway. Good evening.
Sign in afterwards, then?
Yeah, sign in afterwards. That's fine.
Jörg Hensel of 38700 Van Dyke, Sterling Heights, Michigan. Architect representing Mode Development on a new project in Shelby Parkway for a manufacturing facility, which, as you can see, is a fairly large facility. It's evidence that hopefully the jobs are coming back. So I don't know if Glenn wants to take.
Mr. Wynn?
Okay, we have a few. This was the last site on Shelby Parkway, and I didn't think we'd ever get to that point this quickly. And it's nice to see that. We didn't do a preliminary review on this, obviously, because of the time frame that was submitted. We wanted to at least get this before the commission, and we worked with Mr. Hensel and the DeAugustinis much in the past, so we knew we were going to get a really good submission. So we have a few more comments on here, but they're easily correctable. The first is a legal description is required. They didn't have that at the time because they're just parceling this out. This is an odd site because part of the site zoned heavy manufacturing, part of the zone site is zoned light manufacturing. It's mostly heavy manufacturing, but where that applies here is in the heavy manufacturing have a 40-foot building height limitation, and the light manufacturing it's 35. This building's at 40. So I think, you know, I talked to Mr. Kirk about it today, and we both kind of agreed that since we'd kind of treat the majority of the site as being the predominant controlling zoning, which is the HM, the only deviation of that is the silos that they're showing are 50 feet.
Can I address that for a minute, or do you want to wait until you finish?
I'm fine if you want to address it now.
Go ahead. Yeah, go ahead.
That was the worst-case scenario by this manufacturer of the silo sizes for their plastic pellets. So what we can do is make a contingent on the fact that they, if they want something that large, because it could be 35, could right. be 40, to come back and ask for a variance or a zoning approval.
That could happen
at that time when
fine.
They install the, because it's basically equipment. It's not part of the building.
Right. I just wanted to make sure we got that out, and that's a good response. We've done that in the past. Another comment, if there's any outdoor storage, it should be identified. Typically, we don't get a lot of outdoor storage on these buildings, and they've screened the building so the loading areas are all on the south, not on the north, which makes it helpful. Typically, with a building of this size, you bump into the parking requirements, and we have fairly liberal parking requirements for industrial based on the shop size, the manufacturing space size, and or warehousing. So if you calculate this based on the office and the manufacturing, they don't have enough spaces. But intuitively, you know, they have enough spaces to meet the needs of their tenant. So if you calculate the shop area using the warehouse standard, which is probably more appropriate for these types of businesses, because you go in the back there, it's all equipment, it's not a lot of people anymore. They meet the requirements. But I didn't want to just make that calculation without sharing with you how I was doing it. So I'm comfortable. I'd rather do it that way and make an interpretation than send this to the ZBA and slow the process down. It's in their best interest to have enough parking, and they do. The berm, they're showing a berm on the north side of the building to screen what this building means. You're not going to completely screen this, but the building is a long elevation, so they're going to have a berm. Typically, the slopes are 1-4. They change into 1-3, which is still a maintainable slope, and by doing that, you get another 2 feet of height, and you get the trees on top of that, and it will break up that, you know, the facade. Again, you're not getting 40-foot trees, so you're going to see the building, but it gives it a nicer look. So they've taken advantage of the setback adequately. We need a location of a trash receptacle. I'd like to see a photometric plan just for the north wall of the building. Typically now they're using the lights that just shine down, so they won't have a wall pack that projects to the residents, because you have 9 homes across the street. We want to protect those homes at all costs.
And I don't know if it's you can see that on the drawing. We put a note on that north elevation. Our usual lights are at 22 feet. They're fully shielded. On the north side, we're proposing to put the lights down at 14. Because we really don't need the lights up there for any reason. We're not, because usually you put them up at 22 to shed light out into the parking and trucking lanes, but we only have a fire lane on the north side of this building, so we don't need it. So we'll just lower the lights down to 14. The berm's 7 feet tall.
There's a lot of nuances that York has worked through already with this plan. The other one is the way the building looks. You know, it's mostly block and siding, which is typical for the buildings in this area, and it looks fine. They've also broken it up with some glass features in there so that it's not one solid wall of one material, which I think that little design nuance makes the building look a little more attractive as well. The parking light fixtures have to be reduced to 20 feet. They're 28 feet. We want to make sure we're not looking at any HVAC equipment on the top of the building. This building is so big, if it's pushed back far enough, the residents won't see it, but we don't want to be able to see that on the top of the building. Comment from the building department about exit doors may change. The fire department did have a comment about asking for a driveway to 24 Mile Road for emergency purposes only, but it won't be for standard operations.
I did talk to the owner, and we're going to put that in with a lockable gate, so there'll be no traffic
and
exiting 24 miles.
Many of the engineers' comments overlap mine, so I'm fully supportive of this. Again, you know, this is we're taking full advantage of our industrial property by getting these types of manufacturers in here. I remember 10 or 15 years ago, everybody said nobody's ever going to come back, and now they have, and now we don't have enough land left.
Mr. Hensel, oh, go ahead, Mr. Kirk.
We'll also need shared access and parking agreement right in the property split.
Correct. We're going to have shared drive with the south, right?
I have one more. We did have some neighbors come and talk to Scott about this one day at the counter. One of the questions, what kind of equipment in the building?
What kind of equipment?
Yeah. This isn't a stamping presses or?
They're not large presses. They're injection molding.
Okay.
They'll do a lot of plastic molding, so they're not going to be talking about vibration. Is that
right,
what they're
getting at?
Because
there's some standards in the ordinance that if you're next to residential with that equipment, we just want to verify that there wasn't going to be that kind of problem.
Right.
Okay. Okay. The other question, what are the hours of operation? Industrial, they can have three shifts if they want. The advantage on this site is all the activities on the south side of the building. So whether they're open 24 hours or 2 hours, you're not going to notice much difference as a resident.
And that is true. It is going to be 24 hours. Mm-hmm. But every truck well and all the truck traffic is the south side. The only traffic we're going to have on the north side is once a week. The trucks that unload the plastic pellets will make a loop around the building. They won't even stop.
And that loop around the building is also primarily for fire department access. They ask for that. And then finally, the other question was, what the color is going to be, and I'm assuming we're dealing with the same color palette that we have out there already.
Same color palette, yes. Okay. That architecture was established well before
right.
Mr. DeAugustine bought it, or I did the architecture, and you like to keep it consistent. So
I think that does help give a really nice look to the property.
We are adding, there's a lot of stone on this elevation, where it went, but there's a lot more stone on this building than the other ones, and the last couple that we presented to also have entrance features that some of the other ones haven't had, so we are adding some dimension to it.
Mr. Chairman, we try to do that balance between promoting economic development and maintaining our adherence to our standards. I don't think we're compromising anything with our standards on this one, not one bit.
Well, Mr. Hensel made a comment a few months back on one of his other buildings. He said, I just do basic industrial buildings. Mr. Hensel, there's nothing basic of what you do. Everything that you do is fantastic. So thank you,
sir. Thank you.
Any other comments? If not, a motion would be in order.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Pone.
I move to approve the site plan application number 16-41 for Jörg Hensel for property located on the east side of the Shelby Parkway, south of 24 Mile Road, subject to the submission of a revised plan addressing all department comments and approval of any required variances by the Zoning Board of Appeals.
Support.
Motion by Mr. Appone, supported by Mr. Dallow. Any other questions or comments on the motion? Hearing none. Mr. Appone.
Yes.
Mr. Dallow.
Yes.
Ms. Tosico.
Yes.
Ms. Moore.
Yes.
Mr. Wozniak.
Yes.
Didn't forget you that time. And chair votes yes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks again.
Good luck.
Just not on kickoff.
What time is 8:30?
Mr. Wynn, the administrative report.
I guess this will be real quick.
Go ahead.
We had 10 sign applications last month, which I think is the fewest number we've had all year. I've been working with our consultants regarding the master plan, finalizing a few details. We should have that to us this month, before the end of the month, the final draft, which I'd like to have a study meeting sometime next month with the Planning Commission to go over that.
Okay.
And then next meeting we'll have our annual report and election of officers.
All right. Anything else? No more business from the floor, I assume. If not, Mr. Dallow.
Motion to adjourn, Mr. Chairman.
Support.
Moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Meeting adjourned. Have a good night.